Hi friends, welcome back to Prepare for Birth. I'm Dr. Marta Perez, and I'm so excited for this week's episode, questions you're too embarrassed to ask your OB doctor. But you don't have to be embarrassed to ask me, and I'm gonna answer them all. Let's get started. Question number one, what's the difference between my mucus plug and just regular discharge? So the best way to address this is just, what is the mucus plug? So the mucus plug is just what it kind of sounds like. Cervical mucus in the cervical canal can kind of collect there and have a little bit of a more solid appearance that looks like a plug. That can be there during pregnancy when the cervix is more hard and not yet labored. As the cervix starts to soften and open as a part of your body preparing for labor, it may fall out and you may see a clump of discharge that's commonly called a mucus plug. A mucus plug is not a reliable sign that labor is around the corner. Sure, some people may see their mucus plug and go into labor a few hours later or the next day, but some people may lose their mucus plug weeks before labor. They may lose a mucus plug and a new one develops and lose it again. Some women may never see that they lost a mucus plug. So basically, a mucus plug has no significance. It doesn't have any importance. You shouldn't be worried about it. You shouldn't be excited about it. And you definitely don't need to take a picture of it or show your doctor or your nurse or anything. It's just something that you might or might not see. Next question is related. Why do I have so much discharge in pregnancy? The amount of discharge in pregnancy is increased. It's called the physiologic leukocoria of pregnancy. Those words basically mean normal extra discharge of pregnancy. And it's because your body is producing some extra discharge filled with white blood cells so that the flow of discharge is out, preventing bacteria or other harmful organisms to be able to climb their way up the vagina or up the cervix. Many women notice that they have a lot more discharge in pregnancy, and that is normal. Now, if you have big gushes of clear fluid, definitely a reason to talk to your doctor. But having just an increased amount of discharge, as long as it's not making you itchy, doesn't have a foul odor, and the color is a relatively milky color, that's all okay. You can check with your doctor. It's easy to do an exam and rule out an infection, but many times, physiologic leukocoria of pregnancy is completely normal and it's healthy. I don't find this question embarrassing at all, but some of you said it was, and that's asking about sex during pregnancy. The answer is yes. Sex is how you got here. Sex is fine to have during pregnancy. There are a few conditions in pregnancy that we recommend pelvic rest for, which means no vaginal sex. So definitely speak with your doctor. But if you don't have one of those, it's perfectly safe to have vaginal intercourse, oral sex, whatever is the sexual relationship that you want during pregnancy in all trimesters. Orgasms can release oxytocin, which is a hormone that can make your uterus contract, but it doesn't pose any harm to the pregnancy. If you notice some contractions, they should go away in a few minutes. Obviously, if they don't, go see your doctor. There are also a lot of benefits to sex during pregnancy. One of the benefits is it encourages intimacy between you and your partner, which is wonderful. Who doesn't want to bond and feel better with their partner in the months leading through the pregnancy and to the postpartum period when intimacy can be more limited? In pregnancy, there's increased blood flow to the pelvic region in women. That may result in even better orgasms or stronger orgasms. So that's another reason to have sex. Around the due date, as you're approaching your due date, some of the molecules called prostaglandins in semen may actually help the cervix prepare for labor. Now, it's not a tried and true way to go into labor, but it certainly doesn't hurt and is something that has only benefits to try. Many women will actually have an increase in their libido towards the second half of pregnancy because of some of the high hormones produced by the placenta. And so if your libido is high, what better way to satisfy that craving than to have sex? You will have to probably get creative with positions. You know, the bump will get in the way. So getting creative with your partner, doing something that is comfortable for both of you is my advice. But sex is safe, sex is beneficial. Speak to your doctor if you're worried about anything and have fun. Next question. Why are my hemorrhoids so bad and what can I do about them? Hemorrhoids, unfortunately, are a very, very common side effect of pregnancy. And it's for a few reasons. One is that hemorrhoids are caused by the veins that help empty the rectal and anal area. And some of those veins get a little backed up with a big pregnancy in the way. Same as like foot swelling, that kind of thing. And also in pregnancy, you have more intra-abdominal pressure, which increases the likelihood of hemorrhoids. Constipation can contribute to hemorrhoids as well. And constipation is very common in pregnancy. Unfortunately, there's not a whole lot of ways to prevent them. The best things are trying to keep your stool regular and soft and not straining. Those may not be enough. So what do we do to treat them? So the first thing you can do to treat them is to stop them from getting worse. So like I said, if you're not already on stool softeners that help keep the stools, help keep bowel movements regular and soft, do that. There are some medications that you can apply near the anal area that can help relieve the discomfort from them. Talk to your doctor about what their kind of favorite one of those are. And sometimes hemorrhoids get worse before they get better. So they may get worse around the birth process and postpartum, and then get better as you're a little bit more distant in the weeks and months postpartum. For pregnant women who are very bothered by their hemorrhoids, there are, of course, procedures that can address the hemorrhoids. Most of the time we don't do them during pregnancy, though it doesn't mean they can't be done if it's a severe case. I usually refer to my colleagues in colorectal surgery for evaluation and for following. Certainly postpartum, if they're still bothersome and they haven't responded to medications, then a procedure can be warranted. I know, they're annoying. There's not much to do to prevent them. There's not all that much to treat them. But the good news is, for a lot of women, their symptoms really get a lot better after the postpartum period in the weeks or months afterwards. So sometimes patience works. And the most common embarrassing question I hear that nobody wants to ask, but everyone is wondering, will I poop during birth? And the answer is, you might, but it's okay. And it doesn't matter. Your doctors and nurses don't care at all. It's part of a normal part of the birth process. Will you definitely pass a bowel movement during labor or pushing? No. In my experience, it's probably 20%, 10%? I don't know. I don't really keep track because it's not important. You know, as your baby is coming down into the birth canal, into the vagina, past the pelvis, the only other time your body has experienced the feeling of something solid moving through that space is when you're having a bowel movement. So you actually should be pushing like you're trying to have a bowel movement. That's using the right muscles to push the baby. Also, it's kind of like toothpaste. If you had stool that was already collected in your rectum and the baby's head is coming behind that, your baby is taking up a lot of your pelvis, so it may kind of squeeze out some bowel movement at the same time the baby's head is coming out and descending. As doctors and nurses, we just deal with it. Many times you may not even know, because we'll just discreetly wipe it away with a towel and you won't even know any better. But when I do hear that someone's passing a bowel movement while they're pushing, I think, huh, they're pushing in the right spot and doing it correctly. So it's no big deal. Don't stress about it. I can't tell you if you will or won't. You may or you may not, but it's definitely not something to be thinking about and worrying about, because it's just a normal part of the human body. Okay, the next question I get isn't even specific to pregnancy. I get this question a lot just with being an OBGYN, and it's, should I shave my pubic hair before delivery or before my doctor's appointment, etc.? And the answer is, I don't care. Do what is right for you. Doctors do not care about what your hair situation is. Hair is a normal part of the human body, and hair is supposed to be in the genital region. So if hair down there is what's right for you, you rock that hair. Don't change it for your doctors or nurses. If hair really annoys you and you like to remove it, that's fine. Some hair removal strategies may be a little bit more painful in pregnancy due to increased blood flow. And in general, I only like patients to use hair removal strategies that cause the least amount of irritation or infection. And that would be using trimmers. I really advise patients to kind of stay away from shaving and waxing and using chemical anti-hair products, just because they cause irritation. Now, if you love those and they work for you, that's fine, but you may notice they cause irritation and you don't like that. So if you'd like to remove hair, just simply trimming it shorter is what I'd recommend from a doctor perspective for your health. But I support you in whatever hair works for you. It's not better to have hair or better to not have hair, just whatever works for you. I really don't care. Final embarrassing question I got for this round is, what if I'm terrified of labor and delivery? And this brings up a question I've seen a lot in Q&As recently, which was a profound fear of the birth process. It's definitely not unique. I've been seeing it a lot. And so my big thing is, how can we work around finding the right plan for you? So one, I think it's really wonderful when people are able to identify something that is stressing them out, causing them anxiety or a legitimate fear. And the next thing we can move towards is making that fear tolerable or overcoming the fear, or at least dealing with it not affecting our functioning or maybe our choices. In this situation, I absolutely recommend mental health care. Cognitive behavioral therapy is known to be the number one effective treatment for specific phobias. You sometimes hear the word tocophobia as a fear of the birth process. So getting connected with a mental health professional who performs cognitive behavioral therapy is really important. The other things we can talk about as between your doctor and patient is if there are specific fears that you have. Maybe your specific fear is something that doesn't apply anymore. Maybe it's a specific fear of having an episiotomy. Well, in the common day in US obstetrical practice, episiotomies are less than 1% of the time, really, for most doctors. So you may find, oh, I'm suddenly very relieved that that may not happen. Or your fear may be surrounded in a prior birth trauma, something that was really scary and that you keep thinking about from a prior birth. Sometimes going back over those events, understanding that nothing you did was your fault and processing those events in therapy can really help moving forward. So the underlying thing I wanna stress here is communication. Ultimately, if you feel like your fear and anxiety around vaginal birth are so excessive that a primary C-section is right for you, that's a decision you can make with your doctor when discussing all the risks and all the benefits. This is truly a relationship and a doctor-patient relationship type of issue. And if you don't feel comfortable talking to your doctor about this, or you feel if your doctor blew you off, be open to getting a second opinion and kind of finding a doctor or a situation you can trust. Even in group practices, if your doctor is understanding and you have a good relationship, they're going to communicate that to their partners as well in case they're not the ones there during birth. But really being able to talk it out all through prenatal care and communicate well is important. So that's my advice for that. All right, this was a super fun episode to record. I think I'll probably start integrating more Q&A based episodes every now and then where you guys can just ask questions and I will give you the answers in addition to some of my posts that have specific topics on them. So make sure you follow me on Instagram. I usually ask for questions there. You can also ask questions in the comments here. I would love to hear them here to use for next time. And don't forget to subscribe and hit the little bell so you're alerted when I release all of my videos. And I hope you have a wonderful week. I'll see you next Friday.